Mina, konbanwa, Jesus freaking gamer here. This is part two of the whole fears about marriage thing. Thank you. That was a glorious beginning right there. So part one was mostly preamble. It was mostly me trying to get words to form and me trying to get things to work out well. And I definitely didn't finish it, didn't even get to the main fears. It was all just like, you know, here's kind of what marriage should be, here's why I think marriage is a little bit scary. The thing that prompted the fears and doubts is near the end of the first message, after the 25-minute mark, I forget exactly where. So if you're curious about it, you can look there. Basically, it just in summary, it was a moment from the visual novel Clannad, or more specifically, the anime Clannad is when I had the moment, was watching when Tomoya proposed to Nagisa. She said yes, and I was like, you know, that kind of love doesn't exist in this world. In more detail, you can go to that first video. But yeah, I never really finished my train of thought, and I wanted to do that here in a part two. So this is quite a bit later. I apologize that the Sunday messages haven't gone up in the way that I thought they would. So I essentially owe two 30-minute messages. Here is one of them, and I will make sure the other one comes out later on this week. That is, thought it was going to go up last Tuesday. Good grief, that didn't work out well at all. But I'm gonna try to focus here. I freed myself of many obligations this week, so this week should go a lot smoother and a lot quicker. So on to the fears. The fear is very simple, that I have no illusion that Hollywood and anime, any form of media, any form of fiction, they're going to present anything, whether it's a romance, or whether it's action, or whether it's horror, they're going to present it in a glorified way. The action's going to be larger than life, the horror is going to be scarier than life, the romance is going to be more lovely than life. It's all going to be magnified in a way that is fictitious, that does not exist. And that's kind of the thing, when I realized that the kind of love that Tomoya and Nagisa had, you know, this is fictional, and that kind of strong, devoted love doesn't exist. It was a terrifying thought. I've been single for 36 years. I am 36 years old currently, and I have a routine and a rhythm. I know what I do when I wake up at the beginning of the day. I know how I conduct myself during the day. I know the responsibilities that I have. I know the work that I do. And then I'll come home and do YouTube and play some video games and have a good old time. And very, very content with that. But I do believe that the Lord will have me married one day. I believe that there is someone out there for me. And also, I believe that I should not be alone. Like God said in Genesis 2, it's not good for man to be alone. I don't believe I'm one of those that's going to be alone. And there is a very specific reason for that. And this is going to make me look like a horrible human being, but I'm going to be completely open and honest. I said this series was a little bit of a scary thing for me because I'm being so open and so honest about some of the things that are in my heart. So let's just go into this. This is something not a lot of guys will talk about openly, but I'm going to be completely honest. And I know that there's a lot of potential for a lot of people not hearing my heart in this, and a lot of people not understanding exactly where I'm coming from. But I'm going to do my best to be completely open and honest. And if there is confusion, misunderstanding, if people don't hear me all the way out, or they turn off the video early, or even if they watch the whole video and they just kind of don't see where I'm coming from, that is perfectly and totally fine. Or maybe when I am clear, they'll be like, you know, I see exactly where you're coming from. And you're kind of a garbage human being, and your Bible and your God are kind of garbage. And that is perfectly fine. Or maybe like, yeah, the Bible said it correctly, but you're a garbage human being. That's perfectly fine. A lot of me is garbage. A lot of me is still quite sinful. And so maybe what I'm about to say is completely wrong, but I'm going to be honest with you as far as I feel. This is 1 Corinthians 7. I'm going to read verses 8. Is it just verse 9? It's just verse 9. So 1 Corinthians 7, verses 8 and 9. This is Paul speaking, "But I say to the unmarried and to the widows, it is good for them if they remain even as I am. to it single. But if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion. In other words, sex is a big motivator to get married. And that is probably the primary reason why I think I'm going to get married, because I burn. I have a rather strong sex drive. And it, as I've discussed in previous videos, pornography and specifically eroge, they have been strongholds in the past and something I struggle with even to this day. Porn is not something I've completely conquered. Lust is not something I've completely conquered. It's, the battle's real. The struggle is real. And one of my primary motivations for getting married is the sexual release. A lot of guys would never admit to that. And that's why a lot of you may think I'm a garbage human being, saying, well, that's a big reason for me getting married. In fact, Paul mentioned, like, that is, like, if this is an issue, get married so you can have sex. Since Paul the Apostle said it, I think it's okay for me to admit I'm in that boat. And I think it should be okay for other men and women, because women have sexual desires too. Men are not the only perverted beasts out there, you know, sniffing the air, clawing the ground, you know, seeing what they can find. Women have those same desires as well. So if you burn, get married. And based on that advice alone, I think marriage is probably a good idea for me at some point in the future. And if sex is a bad motivation to get married, then I guess I am a garbage human being. Didn't say it was the only motivation for me getting married. I didn't say that I wasn't going to love my future wife. I didn't say I was simply going to marry a woman based on her physical attractiveness. I did not say that. Physical attractiveness is very temporary. Like, human beings look really good when they're younger. If they take care of themselves, they can look okay when they're older. And I just, in my opinion, I look halfway decent for 36. And I also have very young-looking skin, which I definitely got that from my mom. She looked about 10 years younger than she did, and no one ever guesses I'm in my 30s. So, very thankful for that. That's a blessing. So, I think I look halfway decent for a guy in his late 30s. But nonetheless, the physical is going to fade away. And not to mention, if they have a garbage personality, or they're not very intellectually stimulating, kind of dull and boring, and your mileage, every human's mileage varies on all of these issues. But if they're lacking those areas, it would be very hard to marry an individual like that and think to myself, you know, this is not just a one-off. I'm not just, you know, this isn't just a roll in the hand. I'm not just going to have a one-night stand. I'm going to stay with this person for the rest of my life. It's hard for me to imagine doing that with someone who's simply pretty. In fact, that's impossible for me to imagine. If I don't have feelings for her in my heart, I can't imagine marrying her. There's going to have to be something more than the physical. However, on the same line, if I don't feel that physical motivation to have sex with her, that also, it's very hard for me to imagine marrying that person. If I love who they are, but I really don't want to have sex with them, I'm essentially cheating them out of something that they are owed. 1 Corinthians 7 goes on to talk about why, you know, this is a 30-minute message on marriage. Sex is a very big part of marriage. Why don't I simply read this verse? Why would I not do that? Okay, it's not that part. No, I didn't. I had Ephesians 5 prepared ahead of time. I did not have this prepared ahead of time. So I do apologize for that. Da-da-da-da-da. Dead silence in a video, very bad. Let me see here. Let me start in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 25. Now concerning virgins. That would be me. Thank God. I'm so thankful that I still have that to my name and that I can go into whatever I carry into the marriage that is bad and that's sinful, thank goodness. That's not one of the things I carry. I haven't been sleeping around with a bunch of women. In fact, I haven't slept with a single one. Very thankful I can take that to my marriage bed. Now concerning virgins, I have no commandment from the Lord, yet I give judgment as one whom the Lord in his mercy has made trustworthy. I suppose, therefore, that this is good because of the present distress, that it is good for a man to remain as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be loosed. Are you loosed from a wife? Do not seek a wife. But even if you do marry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marries, she has not sinned. Nevertheless, such will have trouble in the flesh, but I would spare you. But this I say, brethren, the time is short, so that from now on even those who have wives should be as though they had none, those who weep as though they did not weep, those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice, those who buy as though they did not possess, and those who use this world as not misusing it. For the form of this world is passing away. But I want you to be without care. He who is unmarried cares for the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he who is married cares about the things of the world, how he may please his wife. There is a difference between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman cares about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she who is married cares about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. And this I say for your own profit, not that I may put a leash on you, but for what is proper, and that you may serve the Lord without distraction. But if any man thinks he is behaving improperly toward his virgin, if she is past the flower of youth, and thus it must be, let him do what he wishes. He does not sin. Let them marry. Nevertheless, he who stands steadfast in his heart, having no necessity, but has power over his own will, and has so determined in his heart that he will keep his virgin, does well. So then he who gives her in marriage does well, but he who does not give her in marriage does better. And so all of that, and let's back up to verse, actually let's go to chapter 7, verse 1. Now concerning the things of, all of chapter 7 is in regards to marriage and sex within marriage. It actually starts off with the sexual part and then moves on to further points about how married couples should behave towards one another, how, obviously what I just read, how if you're single, stay single, if you are married, stay married. It also talks about how if the non-believer wishes to leave, let them leave. The believer should not feel bound to that person. Now I'm going to start with verse 1. Now concerning the things of which you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, because of sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife, and let each woman have her own husband. Again, if you desire sex, get married. For that to be a motivation is okay. If Paul says that's okay for it to be a motivation, then apparently it's okay. And I even, if you're going to think I'm a garbage human being for that, that's fine. But even the Bible says that that is a motivation, a very strong motivation. In fact, it's the single motivation he mentions in this chapter. So for me to say, I desire sex, I should marry, I'm lining up with Scripture. If you still think I'm a garbage human being, you're welcome to feel that way. But I would say at that point, you're disagreeing with God and Scripture. Or if you believe this is Paul speaking rather than God, you're at the very least disagreeing with the Apostle Paul. Which is fine, he's a human, you can disagree with him. I just tend to be on his side in this matter. So on to verse 3, let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another except with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. But I say this as a concession, not as a commandment. For I wish that all men were even as I myself, but each one has his own gift from God, one in this manner and another in that. I personally think this is Paul's opinion, not necessarily God's word. Some people say, well, it's in God's word, so it's in God's word. I hold to the thought, based on that verse there, that Paul is saying this based on what he feels and what he believes, and as one who he later on says in the chapter, God has given some wisdom to. I don't think this is necessarily a command. Therefore, what I would say is if you think I'm a garbage human being and that my motivation is garbage, at the very, very least, you are, at the very, very least, I'm in agreement with Paul and you're in disagreement with Paul. And considering who he was, I feel fairly safe in saying that if sex is one of my motivations to get married, that doesn't make me a bad human. That doesn't make me a bad male. I think that actually, and if you think about it, I think that actually makes me quite normal. So, yeah, there's one part of it right there. That is one of the motivations for me to get married. But like I said earlier, and again, just, this is all in the name of complete and total honesty. At the same time, I understand that this physical appearance is fleeting. I also know that I don't want to be covenanted with someone to stay with them for the rest of my life if I don't like them. That would make very little sense. So there's no way sex can be the only motivating factor to get married. There's no way I can't consider the heart of that other person. And maybe it doesn't go without saying, but the other person that I want to marry, they have to be a Christian. They need to be a Christian in order for me to marry them. 2 Corinthians talks a little bit more about that, about not being unequally yoked. You can look that up as homework. That can be something that you look into in your own time. I won't belabor the point that a Christian should marry a Christian. It's not something to be taken for granted. It's not something that should just be assumed, despite how much the church says it. No truth should simply be assumed. It should always be backed up with the Word of God. But that is a point I will let you research and look into yourself. And then comes the statistic that I mentioned briefly in the other message, that 50% of Christian marriages fail. And the fact that I don't believe that a love, like I saw in the Clannad, can be possible. That kind of devotion and loyalty doesn't exist in this world. Yeah, couples stay together. And interestingly enough, I have an amazing example in my mother and father. My mother's now deceased, as I've mentioned. My father's still alive and well and kicking. And their marriage was amazing. The way he loved her, the way he was close to her, the way she loved him and was devoted to him was exactly what the Bible says. And it was incredible. Of course, I also saw the problems. There were plenty of arguments and fights and quarrels and areas where they didn't get along and areas where they had to compromise and things weren't smooth or easy all the time. And I don't expect things to be smooth and easy all the time. But what I'm looking at is, we're all born sinners, we're all born failures. Not that we should give in to those failures, not that we should give in to those moments of weakness, but a lot of people do. And there are some good Christian marriages that, unlike my mom and dad's, they failed. They failed very badly. And that's quite frankly very scary to me. As someone who's come along in life, as someone who the Lord has blessed, maybe not abundantly, but he's blessed a little bit. There are things that about my life, financially and in my heart, there are things that I want to protect. There are things that I'm not quite sure that I want to let go. One of the ideas that I discussed with a few people was a prenup. A prenup is simply set a contract in advance of the marriage saying, if the marriage falls apart, if divorce happens, this person gets this, this person gets that. It's essentially a way to keep yourself safe. And I'm of the idea of, prenup's probably a pretty good idea. I'm going to the marriage thinking and planning and wanting, praying, hoping, and working towards this working out and lasting for a lifetime. But if it doesn't, if she falls away from the Lord, if I fall away from the Lord again, it's happened once, I have to acknowledge its possibility, I am a failure. If that's the case, prenup's probably a good idea. That way, despite the pain that's going to be caused by the divorce, because I would dare to say within the biblical context of marriage, if the marriage is done before God with the intent of doing this for a lifetime, it's not just a marriage of let's see if this works, I really like this person, so let's spend a few years together. If it's done with the mindset of we're going to do this for the rest of our lives, a divorce with that kind of a mindset is going to hurt. A divorce under various other mindsets like, well, they were a good friend, and it was several good roles in the hay, and I had a few legitimate children by them, so yeah, let's go ahead and get divorced, let's get rid of this. Even then, those divorces are usually like, there's something about this person I really don't like, something I didn't foresee, so let's go ahead and get this done. So there's a grievance. And you usually, when I look at, again, the Christian marriages, again, they were designed for one man, one woman for one life. When those end up in divorce, I have never seen one of those kind of marriages fall apart into divorce without a lot of pain. I've never seen that happen. It usually goes far beyond a grievance. It usually results in deep wounds and heartache for both parties. Unless one party has completely changed their mind, like, you know, the whole Christian thing, we're just kind of abandoning that. We're not doing that anymore. I'm not doing that anymore. I've changed my mind on God, on the Bible, on marriage, on you, sweetheart. So let's end this thing. Let's not do this anymore. Unless the entire mindset has changed, if they're still of the mindset of, you know, we should be together, we should stick this out, and then you fail, there's a lot of pain there. And I want to prevent myself from going through that pain, or at least some of that pain, if it happens. Since that love at the end of Clannad isn't possible and doesn't work, maybe there should be some kind of a safety net. Since we're both failures and we're both sinners, maybe something should be put in place where I can at least, you know, keep my finances, keep my home, keep my business. Or, and if I fail, she can keep her home, her finances, her business, and I'm not just tearing her down. This doesn't just go one way. This helps both parties. And I haven't talked to a single Christian who thinks that's a good idea. In fact, the believers that I've talked to about this idea so far have said, well, Brandon, I think you've pretty much narrowed yourself down to about 5% of the potential female population that would want to marry you. If you want to do a prenup of any kind, you've severely limited what you want to do. And the reason that they say that is because they said that basically when you do a marriage, you're going all in. It's all in. It's all or nothing. And so essentially, if something happens to destroy that marriage, you know, not a single part of you is safe. Not your mind, not your will, not your emotions, not your spirit, not your body, not your finances, not your home, not your business. Everything is on the line, and you put everything on the line when you go into marriage. And to go ahead and do a prenup is essentially saying, this marriage very well may fail. There's a chance that it may fail. So let me go ahead and protect myself now. You're going to the marriage holding something back. And my argument to them was very simply, well, yeah, we're failures. We're sinners. It could very well fail. Why not set up the safety net ahead of time? Why not make sure that despite the pain that this will cause, at least some part of us is safe? Again, this is not just for me. If anything, I'm the one who's fallen away from the Lord once. I know my potential to fall. Let's make sure that there's some protection there in case I go stupid again. Or if, and since she's a sinner as well and a failure as well, she could fall away from the Lord, or at the very least fall away from me. Let me set up a safety net to protect myself. Let me make sure that some of my stuff is safe. I remember what my pastor was, one of the people that I consulted on this. I really trust him and love him as a man of God. From what I can tell, he's into Jesus all the way. His life is completely committed to God. And he's had a very successful marriage for, my, how? Going on 30 years now. So he's done very, very well for himself marriage-wise. And the line he gave me was interesting. He said, "You know what, Brandon? If my wife left me right now, and she took everything, not just half, if she took everything," and he actually gave me some legal counsel about where I live, according to my own state's laws, like, you know, what I'm liable for and what I'm not. He gave me some practical wisdom as well, which I'm very, very thankful for. He didn't just cover his point of view. He tried to cover both sides. Again, that just speaks to me of the excellence of his spirit. He said, "You know what? If my wife took not just half, but she took everything, I'd be fine." He said, "I think one of the re," he said, "I don't think you quite understand what it means to have and to lose." He said, "If I were to lose everything, I'd be fine. I'd make it. I'd keep working. I'd build myself back up from nothing, and I would just keep on going." And I mentioned some of the pain that I've seen in Christian couples that have divorced, and it can easily result in bitterness and hatred and a huge inner obstacle to overcome. And my pastor's advice was very blunt and to the point. As a blunt to the point person, I had to appreciate it. And I chuckled a little bit. He said, "Brandon, honestly, that's their problem and they have to deal with it." That sounds almost heartless. But there is a lot of truth to that. It is their problem, and they are the ones who have to overcome it. If they've fallen into bitterness or hatred, when the Bible tells us very plainly to love and forgive all sins, even our enemies, I can't argue with them biblically on that point. That's absolutely correct. And the thing that's been going through my mind, and I am considering it very strongly, this is Ephesians 5. I think I'm going to read the verses before I launch into the point. Let's start at verse 22, a verse that a lot of people hate. But let's read past just the verse 22. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Bam! You want to click away from the message and just finish this up right now? Please don't. Please let me keep reading and get to the husband's responsibilities, because the wife isn't the only one commanded to do something here. For the husband is head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Again, please don't click away. Let me read what the husbands are supposed to do. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. And then he goes on to say in verse 32, this, being marriage, is a great mystery. And the other things that are in the following verses are a part of this great mystery, which are a part of marriage. Feel free to read the full context here to see if I'm saying this right. I always encourage you guys to do that. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. So marriage is a formula of Christ's love for the church. And what did Christ give for the church? He gave everything. He held nothing back. He gave it all. Knowing, not just expecting or thinking, knowing we would fail. Time and again, he still gave it all. And then there's also in verse 11, I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 7, 11b. The first part has to deal with the wife's responsibility. I want to look at the husband's responsibility. And a husband is not to divorce his wife. The first few parts talk about like kind of separation. Like if the wife wants to leave the husband, she should remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. Again, just doing everything. Biblically, you're not supposed to divorce unless there's adultery involved. So short of adultery, divorce is literally commanded by the Lord not to be done. Divorce is forbidden. But even under circumstances of separation, a husband is not to divorce his wife. So the husband has to love her and never, ever, ever leave her unless adultery is involved. The husband is, even if a separation occurs, that's the wife's call, not the husband's. The Lord does not permit the husband to do so. The husband has to stay through thick and through thin, for better or worse. Those traditional marriage oaths, there's a reason they're said the way they're said. They're based pretty accurately from what I can tell on the Word of God. So the model that Christ gives me is to surrender everything. And in fact, spoke with a sister in Christ who'd gone through a divorce and gone through the pain of it and the various resolutions that had to happen throughout it. And interestingly enough, when I talked about the prenup and protection, of course, she said, you know, like I said, no one agreed with me and thought it was a good idea. When I said, you know, well, shouldn't I try to protect something? Shouldn't I try to minimize the pain and the damage? And she said, if that's how you feel, if you're trying to protect at least your finances, because a prenup really can't protect much else other than finances and the home and various assets. She said, if that's how you feel, if that's what you're trying to protect, then you should make sure that when you go into marriage, you should sign a prenup saying that if anything happens, everything's given to your wife. And instead of having a shared account, you should put everything in your wife's account and give her complete control. Because he who seeks to save his life will lose it, but he who is willing to give up his life will save it. Those are the words of Jesus. Again, homework for you guys to look up. I have to admit, because of the way the conversation went, I feel like the Holy Spirit was all over that conversation, and her words really did move me. And I'm considering strongly what she said. But I'm still not completely convinced. I'm still not completely sure. And that's it for this message. Not a very good message to give an altar call on. And a lot of you, again, based on, well, sex is a motivation to marry. And even then, you still want to do the prenup and hold things back. Some of you may very well think, well, this guy, he's not a very good human being, much less a good Christian. And you're fine to feel that way. It was a bit risky for me opening up to this extent to you guys. You're not my inner circle. You're not my closest of friends. But I wanted to keep my struggle open, honest, and real before all of you. I wanted y'all to know who I was. I wanted you to know who I am. And I think this message, in the middle of my not having a resolution, in the middle of my fears and doubts, in the middle of my weakness, this shows you very well who I am in this area. I haven't withheld this from you guys, and I'm leaving myself open to public criticism, much less the criticism of my friends, who, once again, no one thought that what I said was a good idea. None of the Christians thought that this was a good idea. So let me know in the comments down below what you think of this. Biblically or otherwise, I'm open to it all. I'm still going to give an altar call. This is a 30-minute message. If you want to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe you died on the cross for me, shedding your blood for my sin, and I believe you rose again from the dead 3 days later, guaranteeing me eternal life in heaven. Please, right now, forgive my sin. Be my master, my God, and my Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer, I know this message didn't lead into it, but if you prayed that prayer because you just felt the need to accept this wonderful, loving God who gave everything for you, then congratulations, you are now in the family of God, and it is good to have you. Read the Word of God a little bit every day. Find a church that believes in Jesus and believes in the Bible like you, and make sure to show the smallest of prayer. Prayers to God each and every day, even if it's a simple God, thank you for this day, or God, this day sucks, help me. Those little prayers God hears and He answers. I simplified and shortened the altar call because I'm a bit over time here. That doesn't mean God didn't hear you when you prayed. And I, again, if with a 30-minute message, I felt like I would be forsaking my duty if I didn't give people a chance to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, even though the message had nothing to do with an altar call. It did have to do with Christ giving everything. And that is the model for Christian husbands, which one day I believe I will be. Guys, thank you very much for hearing my heart out on this entire matter. Even if you disagree with me, if you watch this whole thing, thank you so much for your time. I love you, and God bless.